Conservation Society, and Dr. Sanderson will be introduced by Captain Stephen Morganson of the Christopher School of Architecture here at CUNY. And we're very happy to have you all here sharing your Friday night with us for this presentation. This is the most recent and ongoing series of lectures that we've collaborated with NYC H2O on, focused on water and urban sustainability here in New York City. And my name is Douglas Price. I'm the program manager of the CUNY Institute for Sustainable Cities. We're a research organization that's based here at Hunt College, and we focus on urban sustainability issues, primarily climate change mitigation, climate resilience, and ecosystem services. And water is one of the most important aspects of urban sustainability. So we've had a long series of lectures with NYC H2O focused on water issues, and this is a particularly important presentation for us because we've collaborated with Dr. Sanderson on a number of projects in the past, including most recently Prospects for Resilience, Insights from New York City, a book that he's recently published with Adam Harris, the Science and Resilience Institute at Jamaica Bay, and with the founding director of our institute, Dr. William Selecki, and also John Waltman of Queens College. So a lot of CUNY representation there. And we've also been focused, we've done a lot of our own research projects focused on sustainability in the Jamaica Bay area. And so I'm looking forward to hearing what Dr. Sanderson has to say. And let's see, is Matt here?
Yes.
I can't see it. So I'd like to turn the mic over to Matt Molina of NYC H2O.
Thank you, Doug. I'd like to thank Doug and the Institute for Sustainable Cities for hosting us tonight. Welcome, everybody. My name is Matt Molina. I'm the director and founder of NYC H2O. We're honored to have such a full house tonight and excited about the presentations you're about to hear from Eric Sanderson and Catherine Stephen Robinson. I see a lot of new faces in the audience tonight. I'm kind of curious, raise your hand if this is your first NYC H2O event. Fantastic. Wow. Welcome. So I'd like to just tell you a little bit about NYC H2O and the programs that we offer. Let me just grab my clicker. NYC H2O is a nonprofit organization. We offer public programs like these, and we have one coming up at the Queens Museum about with the watershed map. It's a three-dimensional model, 30 feet by 20 feet, and it has lights that light up that show the path of the aqueducts. And we'll have two engineers lead that presentation. One of them is in the back, Peter. Welcome. And we'll have two engineers for that program. So that'll be in January. In February, we're super excited to have Blackjacks, a lecture about African American sailors in the 19th century. New York being a harbor town, it played a huge part of our history. So we're real excited about that. That'll be at Brooklyn Borough Hall. We do volunteer park and beach cleanups, and we'll resume those in April in Staten Island at Lemon Creek. We do bike tours here in the city, walking tours, and we do paddling trips upstate in the watershed on the reservoir. So we hope you can join us for those in the warmer weather. A big focus of our work is offering free water ecology and engineering field trips to schools. And we bring the students to incredible infrastructure sites, reservoirs, wetlands in all five boroughs. We get the kids out there and to see firsthand these inspiring places. Students get to learn about their infrastructure and how it connects with ecology and history. The field trips take place in all five boroughs. There's an old reservoir in each of the boroughs, which makes it very convenient for us. And Plum Beach and Lemon Creek are wetland sites. And we teach about stormwater and sustainability there. In 2015, we gave 91 free field trips, reaching 2,500 students, mostly from Title I schools. Those are underserved schools. And this past year, we provided 141 field trips, reaching almost 4,000 students. Thank you. And the high quality of these programs are due to our incredible staff of field guides, and I'd like you guys just to stand up and just wave, and I'd like to offer. Our tremendous growth is thanks to our many sponsors, corporations and agencies, and a lot of individual donors as well. So thank you to all of them. Just to go through some of our sites, here's the Central Park Reservoir, just a few blocks from here. In Staten Island, there's Silver Lake, and these are active programs, so we play tree races with our students to get them excited about learning about trees. This is at Baisley Pond, which is in Jamaica, Queens, and we use these great large maps that students can trace the path of the aqueducts with their fingers, are very hands-on, and connect where they are with the reservoirs upstate. This is up at Jerome Park in the Bronx. And we have the students build an aqueduct out of straws and tape, and it works. And they learn firsthand that our water system is gravity-based and that aqueducts leak. And it's very important that when they grow up, they work on the water system because it's an incredibly important part of our city. Here we are at the Ridgewood Reservoir, which is on the border of Brooklyn and Queens. And, It's a beautiful place if you haven't had a chance to visit it. It was actually built the same year as the Central Park Reservoir, but it was built for the city of Brooklyn. And Brooklyn was its own city. And we love the Ridgewood Reservoir. Lemon Creek is out in Staten Island on the South Shore, and it's a wetland. It's actually the first site of the Staten Island Blue Belt system. And it's a beautiful park, and we'll have a cleanup there in April to get the site ready. And in Plum Beach, we learn about marine ecology and coastal resilience and the engineering that goes into that. It's an especially fun time, a place to visit in the springtime, because that's horseshoe crab mating season. And if you've ever seen a horseshoe crab, they have 12 legs, and they look like creatures from outer space, and the kids absolutely love them. So we love Palm Beach. If you like the work that we do, we invite you to become more involved, become an H2O BFF, and we have different levels of support. We'll have iPads after the program. We invite everybody to join us for cookies and coffee afterwards, and please come meet us. We're wearing these blue buttons with our names on it. So we invite you to get more involved. Again, I'd like to thank our sponsors, without whose support these programs would not be possible. Here are some of them. Many of them are here in the audience tonight, so I'd just like to give a quick round of applause for us. Thank you again. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Catherine Stevens-Nordenson. She is a professor of landscape architecture at CUNY School of Architecture. If you haven't seen her work on Jamaica Bay, there's a link in the program. It's absolutely incredible, the work that her team has put together. I encourage you to check it out. So without further delay, please join me in welcoming Catherine Stevens-Nordenson.
Welcome to this wonderful event hosted by NYC H2O and Hunter College Institute for Sustainable Cities. My name is Catherine Stevens-Nordenson. I am an associate professor of landscape architecture at City College's Spitzer School of Architecture. We're part of CUNY, like Hunter. I see some people in the crowd. And I also want to just extend a really warm thank you to Matt Molina and his colleague Jamie Jensen, who invited me to come introduce this event. And to express my appreciation for the work that you do for some of our youngest citizens. It's very important work. And I'm delighted to have the privilege to introduce Dr. Eric Sanderson, whose work I have long admired, and with whom I share an interest in the deep history of intertwined ecology of humans and nature in New York City. Dr. Sanderson is a senior conservation ecologist at the Wildlife Conservation Society and teaches also at New York University and Columbia University. He's perhaps best known for his work as the director of the Manhattan Project, an effort to reconstruct the original ecology of Manhattan Island at the time of the arrival of European colonization to the New World in the early 17th century. I first learned of Dr. Sanderson's work almost 10 years ago when reading the October 2007 issue of The New Yorker. Nick Palmgarten's profile of the then-nascent Manhattan Project cast Sanderson as a fascinating character, particularly his mining of historic maps as a kind of time-traveling fieldwork operation, geo-coordinating the 1776 British headquarters map and the 1808 Randall Farm maps to a radically transformed topography of Manhattan. This was of particular interest to me at the time, as we had just launched a study of New York's Upper Harbor called On the Water, Palisade Bay. We were trying to think productively about New York's changing shoreline in light of sea level rise and the risk of flooding from storm surges. And like Sanderson, we sought to map New York's past shorelines to consider how these might be changed again to perform more resiliently and in an ecologically sound manner for an unknown future. Sanderson's fieldwork, of course, led to his best-selling book of 2009, Manhattan, A Natural History of New York City. Since then, he's expanded his work of historical ecology to include all five boroughs, much like NYC H2O, with the creation of the Welikia Project. And most recently, he's been working with the Science and Resiliency Institute of Jamaica Bay to study both the history and the future of Jamaica Bay, work that is the subject of his most recent co-edited book, launched just 3 weeks ago at Hunter's Roosevelt House, entitled Prospects for Resilience, Insights from New York City's Jamaica Bay. Jamaica Bay has been a site of significant interest in New York City since it was slammed by Hurricane Sandy's surge 4 years ago. I spent a few of those years leading a team of researchers at City College of New York to develop novel resiliency strategies for the Bay as part of a project entitled Structures of Coastal Resilience, funded by the Rockefeller Foundation and with the support of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. During the course of this project, it has been a delight to interact with Dr. Sanderson on several occasions, and I continue to be fascinated by the direction of his research. Dr. Sanderson's most recent work, particularly the Visionmaker.nyc mapping tool, is remarkable in its humanist approach to the possibilities of holistic adaptation and the potential of a radically transformed urban future, given the realities of our changing climate. I very much appreciate his insistence on looking to the past to consider our intentions for the future. Again, the subject of his mapping study of the long history of the marshes of Jamaica Bay in his recent article, Cartographic Evidence for Historical Geomorphological Change and Wetland Formation in Jamaica Bay, New York, appearing in a recent volume of Northeastern Naturalist. Here, he looks at the maps of the bay from the 16th century through the mid-19th century to better understand this densely urbanized tidal lagoon of today, its barrier island of the Rockaway Peninsula, and its wetland marsh islands. To introduce Jamaica Bay along with Dr. Sanderson, I'd like to briefly take you on to the bay on a field trip to share a more compressed history of the transformation of the bay and its marsh islands as seen from the air, not with maps, but with the images produced since the advent and advance of aerial photography, satellite images, and drone footage from the 1920s through today. These images are extracted from one of the volumes of our Jamaica Bay pamphlet library, compiled during the Structures of Coastal Resilience project, all accessible online if you'd like to see more. So you were looking at some kids from 75 years ago riding their bikes around the Belt Parkway, the first belt bike path that was integrated with a highway. This is Robert Moses's Belt Parkway in 1941, a couple years after it opened. And here's one of the first aerial views of the bay from 1938. Again, I mentioned these come from a library of work that we did in addition to the resiliency work, and I'm showing you just one of these, the aerial imagery. So let's start in 1938. Those are those skewed aerial views you saw in the beginning, and then a few tiled images on the right going across the Cross Bay Boulevard. But if we back up to the earliest images of photographic images from the bay that I've sourced, these are from 1924 on the left, and it's actually kind of difficult to figure out where the land ends and the water begins. It's a pretty rhizomatic space. To the right, 1951, you can start to see some interesting changes. In fact, in 1924, you're actually starting to see the construction of the Cross Bay Boulevard cutting through those islands in the middle of the bay. On the right, you can see the almost completion of that highway and also some new islands that have suddenly appeared, Canarsie Paul, which didn't exist over here, and Little Egg Marsh. So those are both formed by the spoils of dredging the bottom of the bay for shipping. By 1956, on the left, you can see that Robert Moses had a very unexpected environmentalist moment, where along with the creation of a new rail bed for the subway, which was going to cut across the bay parallel to the Cross Bay Parkway, he creates the wildlife refuge at Jamaica Bay, these two lagoons from which the sand for that trestle bridge was extracted. So we have two freshwater lagoons in the middle of the bay. On the right, you can see 1974. This is the first official mapping of the wetlands of Jamaica Bay by the Department of Environmental Conservation. It's also, 1974 is also the year that New York City, down on its luck, hands over much of Jamaica Bay, including the Marsh Islands, to the National Park Service as part of the Gateway National Recreation Area. In 1989, you can actually start to make out not many changes, but a little bit of loss. And so this starts to be noticed by scientists as well as local residents in the bay that the Marsh Islands were starting to disappear. By 1996, the problem's getting worse and worse. In 2002, the Army Corps of Engineers, in partnership with the National Park Service, decided they wanted not to restore, but to recover the islands back to their footprint of 1974. So a project was initiated at two islands at the north part of the bay, Elders East and West, to actually recreate the marshes by creating, using dredged material, no longer called spoil, but seen as an opportunity and resource, but what's been moved out of the bottoms of our waterways for navigation was now being used to recreate wetlands at the northern part of the bay. In 2012, you can see the completion of those two islands and the initiation of the next big project from the Corps for Yellow Bar Hassock. The northern part of this marsh island is beginning to be restored. You can see the sand being placed right here. Is this one brighter? Oh, okay, so now on the right, you can see actually the completion. This is 2012. I know that's an important date when you think about major life-changing events in our city. This is pre-Sandy, just a few months before, and you can see that, in fact, Yellow Bar Hassock's completed, and there's beginning to be sand placed on these two little islands close to Broad Channel, which is the community in the middle of the bay right here. That's Blackwall and Rulers Bar Marsh Islands. 2013, you can see what happened after Sandy. Actually, the islands do just fine, but in fact, there's a breach in one of Robert Moses's ponds. That's the West Pond at the Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge. And on the right, I zoom in a little bit so you can see that bridge a little more clearly, and the three restored wetlands. This is actually the Yellow Bar Hassock, Rulers Bar, and Blackwall here, which were then planted with marsh grasses with local volunteers. The Army Corps planted this marsh. But you can see the breach there, so we sent out our researcher with his drone, and we violated FAA airspace to get these images. Don't tell anyone. Is this recording? But essentially, we sent it up from two of those hot pink points. We sent up the quadcopter and took a look down at how the marsh was doing. So this is from 2014, Blackwall Channel. You can see Elders East, which has been fully restored here, and these marsh grasses, that's Spartina alterniflora. 2014, Yellow Bar Hassock again, another view. Same quadcopter. Looking back at the city, where you start to see the scale of Jamaica Bay, it's an enormous place. That's the skyline of Manhattan at the top. And this is looking at Pumpkin Patch Channel. And here's Eli holding the drone controls. This is the breach at the West Pond, which apparently the National Park Service has finally decided they will close, because in fact, even though there was no freshwater ecology here historically, it's drawn such an incredible suite of shorebirds that in fact it's become a very interesting learning opportunity for students, for example, and birders love it. So that should be restored. You can see now JFK in the background. And then here's Little Egg Marsh, which was partially formed from dredged spoils, but now a thriving upland maritime forest and wetland as well. And you can also see some Chinese ladies out there harvesting clams. Not sure if that's a good idea. But just to close, we'll look straight down at that one species, the Spartina alterniflora, to think about this incredible place called wetland, which is exactly that, neither land nor water, but something funny and in between that's inundated twice a day with the tides. So to conclude, it's with great honor and delight that I welcome Dr. Sanderson to Hunter College to present this evening's talk entitled A Historic Perspective on Water in New York City with a Focus on Jamaica Bay. Welcome, Eric.
Thank you, Catherine. Philip, if it was up to me, we'd just continue listening to Catherine speak, because that was wonderful. And I really recommend that you look at Catherine's work. It's really fantastic and kind of endlessly fascinating, thinking about Jamaica Bay. And I'm going to follow right along with that. And I want to start tonight with this quote from E. Cummings, that he probably penned along the edge of Minetta Water, which was a stream that used to run through Greenwich Village. And he wrote, one of his poems, "For whatever we lose, like a you or a me, it's always ourself we find in the sea." So I'm going to talk about the waters of New York City and what we've learned through the Welikia Project. And I'm going to particularly emphasize Jamaica Bay. So many people know about our work on Manhattan that was referenced before. Trying to understand what this long, narrow wooded island was like when Henry Hudson showed up in September 12, 1609, and saw something that looked kind of like this. That's Henry Hudson's ship, the Half Moon, and the Hudson River there on the left. A really remarkable place, 54 different ecological communities, more than 1,000 different species, and people. People have been living here, the Lenape people, for over 8,000 years when Henry Hudson showed up. A little bit longer than us European types have been here. So this is Manahata. The word Manhattan is actually a Lenape word. Manahata ended in, we finished that work in 2009. We had an exhibition at the Museum of the City of New York, and I wrote a book, and I was really tired. But I was giving a lot of talks, and at the end of almost every talk, someone would say to me, "Well, what about Brooklyn? You're not going to do the Bronx? Come on, what about Queens?" Even some rare souls would talk to me about Staten Island, and so I picked myself up, and ever since 2009, we've been working on the rest of the city. And it's a lot of work, this work. It's really interesting, it's great, but this is actually the first time in public I've shown this image. This is one of our first renderings of what the whole city might have looked like 400 years ago when Henry Hudson arrived. We have the Lenape word for Manhattan because it was always an island, and so they came up with a name, but of course the Lenape didn't see 400 years ahead to the greater city of New York, or 300 years ahead. So they didn't really have a name for New York, and so we've had to give old New York a different name, and we picked this other Lenape word, Welikia. Welikia, which is a greeting. It's what you'd say to someone when they came to your wigwam or your log house. You'd say, "Welikia, welcome to my good home." And I think that's the way I like to think about New York City, and that's the way I hope you'll think about New York City. It's not just a great place for arts and culture and economy and big buildings and taxi cars and all those wonderful things, but also a great place for nature. Because in fact, you can't have a great city without great nature. And this has been one of the things that we've been learning, especially over the last 15 or 20 years, is about the tremendous ecological potential of our place. It's just hard to see it sometimes when you're looking at a landscape that looks like this. And I think that's really one of the powers of historical ecology. For me, it's a way into urban sustainability. To just show people the changes that have happened. Not to browbeat people or to moralize about it, but just to show, put two things in the same place in comparison to each other over a long period of time. And I think it really has four values. One is it helps us extend the time frame of our thinking. If you just look at the city today, it's really hard to imagine where it might go. But if you look at something that was really different sometime in the past, then it suggests that there's a historical trajectory between them. And moreover, we're part of a historical trajectory going forward. Two, it helps us demonstrate how nature makes places. We're all familiar with the stories of skyscrapers and roads and the Dutch colonization, and all the various aspects, the Erie Canal and so forth, that created New York City. But in fact, nature makes places too, and as you'll see, Jamaica Bay is a wonderful example of how nature makes place. These factors are still going on, and the things that we need to be thinking about as we imagine our city into the long-term future. Third, it helps us imagine the ecological potential. You know, artists and scientists and creative people of all kinds have been going to nature for thousands of years to get inspiration and to really see how nature works and how we can make works from nature. And I think it's important to see that ecological potential in our city. And further, to actually drive that to metrics of sustainability success. If we can make our built ecosystems last as long as the natural ecosystems they replaced, then our city can actually last that long. Not just you know, another 4 years, another marriage term, or another couple decades, or our lifetimes, but actually the lifetimes of our children and our grandchildren. And I think a really good example of that is a couple of these maps that I made right after Hurricane Sandy. This was our current, our version of the historic wetlands of New York City at the time, those green areas. It's changed a little bit since then, but that's where we were then. This was the evacuation zones in October of 2012. And if you lay over them, they look like this. So it's actually no wonder that the places that flooded across New York City were the places that we filled in wetlands. It's always been a lot of work to fill in wetlands, and wetlands, as Catherine said, are the places where the land and the water meet. So what I want to try and talk to you about tonight is Jamaica Bay. And Jamaica Bay is Mother Nature intended it, if you like. If we could go back 400 years ago and be sailing with Henry Hudson on his ship and come to the mouth of Jamaica Bay, what might we have seen? And the goal is really to use this information to try and make a better city going forward. A lot of people know Jamaica Bay as the green thing they see when they're landing or taking off from JFK Airport. You know, that's actually one of the great things about New York City, and everybody knows New York, even if they've never been here before, because they have seen pictures of it. Jamaica Bay is arguably the most important natural area in New York City. It's certainly the largest stretch of tidal wetlands in New York City. It's also on the southeastern side of the city, facing the Atlantic Ocean, so it's very important in terms of long-term resilience. It's also full of these really funky, great neighborhoods with their own kind of architectural styles and their own histories and their own communities of people and their own sets of issues. It's really a, you know, like all of New York City, it's just full of dynamic, interesting people who have dynamic, interesting things to say very loudly to you. it's also a really dynamic, natural place. In ecology, we talk about disturbances, but these are like really extreme disturbances. You know, they're plants that are designed to be buried by the sand that comes from the shore, or you have these plants that are specially adapted to be flooded by salt water twice a day. There are other things that live there. You know, there are other inhabitants in New York City. It's not just the people that go to the ballot box and vote, but all the other living things are here with us, whether they're sandpipers or diamondback terrapins or the other amazing creatures. And all of these organisms, human and non-human, had to deal with Hurricane Sandy in 2012, which is just the latest in a whole long history of hurricanes and extratropical storms that have affected Jamaica Bay. In Prospects for Resilience, the book that was mentioned, we had a table of all the bigger storms that we know about, and it takes 3 pages in the book to list them all. Of course, Sandy is famous for all the damage it caused, and the damage was terrible. Very destructive. People lost their lives, not just from the flooding, but from the fires that followed. And of course, this has created a whole wave of interest and desire by the city to become more resilient and really helped organize efforts from the federal government to the state government to the city government through the neighborhoods that have worked, you know, well in some cases and not so well in others. It's also galvanized the scientific and design communities. You know, Catherine's work comes out of this. This new Science and Resilience Institute, Jamaica Bay. Actually, the idea of it was actually formed before Hurricane Sandy, but it's really taken on power after that. It's based at Brooklyn College. It's a consortium of 10 universities and one conservation organization, the Wildlife Conservation Society, really trying to bring science to the questions of resilience. And our book just came out. 50 authors, 4 editors, everything you need to know, not to make resilience, but as a foundation for resilience going forward. Jamaica Bay is bringing a lot of effort, a lot of attention, and part of that, which we should all be aware of, is the plan to build a floodgate barrier, a tidal floodgate barrier across the Rockaway Inlet, which I'll come back to at the end of my my talk. This is the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers tentatively selected plan. This is that particular vocabulary of stabilization of the Rockaway Peninsula, of a floodgate system across the mouth of the bay and extending over onto Coney Island, including a whole variety of ecosystem restorations inside of the bay. This tentatively selected plan, which the comment period just closed for it, but it's going to be expensive. It would cost an estimated $3.8 billion to make this thing happen. So we should ask ourselves if that's a good idea or not, or whether there's other solutions. And that's what I want to try and get into now, is to help you understand through the process of how we've learned what Jamaica Bay was like in the past, how 1609 compares to 2016. And you can see, just looking at these two images, really how different the bay has become. So the way we figure out what was here historically is by looking at old maps, like this one, the Hassler's map from 1844. This is one of the U.S. Coast Survey's maps. The U.S. Coast Survey is this fascinating institution, the first scientific institution of the federal government, founded in 1807 under Thomas Jefferson. With the goal of mapping the coast. And, you know, back in that time, being a map maker was the very height of science. And they hired this really crazy man, Ferdinand Hassler, who was a Swiss surveyor, mathematician, famous for being so picky in particular about his mapping, to run the survey. And they started their work here in New York City. So we have maps from the Coast Survey that started in the 1830s and run forward into the early 20th century. This is Hassler's famous chart of New York Harbor, and you can see Jamaica Bay there on the right and the extensive wetlands around it. We take these maps and we geo-reference them, which is we bring scans of them into the computer, and we give them a modern geography so we can lay other data on top of it. In this case, we've laid the building footprints of the city on top of the Hassler map, when their buildings are red in this case. So you can see how extensively developed the landscape has become. You can also see, I don't know if you can quite pick it out, but there's some buildings out here in the water. That's a good point. There's some out here on the marshes, Howard Beach, and Broad Channel, Marine Park over here, and of course the buildings of JFK Airport. We then trace features off these maps. This is the wetlands, are in green on this, or light yellow on this map. We trace topographic features, including the underwater topography, the bathymetry. And we traced the shoreline. And when I was working on Manhattan, we had one really great map, the British headquarters map, that was referenced from the 1780s. And we were able to geo-reference that and then do a lot of our work based on that. But as we've expanded the work over the rest of the city, the Welikia Project, we've actually had to use hundreds of maps, not all from the same time. Some from the 19th century, because the development occurred later in the rest of the city compared to Manhattan, we can use maps from the early 19th century. But that also created another problem, which is knowing where the shoreline is. Because of course, sea level rise has been happening this whole time, right? So the shoreline on a map from 1844 is different than the shoreline on a map from 1866, and different from 1888. So we compare it to maps of sea level. This is actually a particularly long-term reconstruction. This goes back 20,000 years, the sea level. And you know, sometimes in the climate change conversation, we talk about sea level like it's just something that's happening now or happening because of climate change. And it is happening because of climate change. But in fact, sea level change has been happening for a long time. And my colleague at WCS, Chris Bagnoli, put together some maps to try and indicate this. So if we were to go back 20,000 years ago, this is an approximation of where the shoreline would have been. And you're probably wondering, where is New York City on this map? Well, it's back here. You see that? So the shoreline at the height of the last glaciation was 120 meters lower in this part of the world than it is today. That meant that it was 100 miles from what's New York Harbor out to the shore, which meant that there wasn't a New York Harbor. There was just a valley, right, with a river going through, which was the Hudson River at the time. And Jamaica Bay was just a little divot on the side of a hill, right? A long way, 100 miles from the shore, like it is from here, you know, up to the Hudson River Valley. If we go 15,000 years, the shoreline's gonna be a little closer. 10,000 years, you see it's starting to get a little bit closer, but even Long Island Sound hasn't formed yet, back here. 5,000 years ago, we start to see Long Island Sound. and then today, our shoreline today. So as this happened, you know, there were beaches on that shore out here. And those beaches moved, you know, they came in closer. There were beaches and there were salt marshes back behind, just like we have today. And the water would come up and it would flood over the top of the beaches and it would flood the salt marshes. And then some of the salt water would flood into the terrestrial vegetation, into the forests that were there, and would kill that vegetation and create the way for the salt marshes to move. And you got this migration that went 100 miles until finally we get to where we are with today. This is showing the same thing, but just over the last 200 years, using a different reconstruction technique, but showing the sea level rise since the American Revolution in this part of the world. So what we do is we use this sea level and we apply it onto a map of the topography. So this is called a digital elevation model, or a DEM, digital elevation model. And these colors are representing different depths and heights. And in this case, we've drained all the water away, right? So that you can see how shallow Jamaica Bay was, and then you can see the sort of shallow plains, and you can see the way the colors are, that some of these are very, you know, 1 foot, 2 foot, 3 foot. So there was this very shallow coastal plain here. This is the moraine that goes across Brooklyn. This is, you know, Prospect Park and Park Slope and Bay Ridge over here and off into Queens. This is the old moraine that was left by the glaciers. So in the last glaciation period, the glaciers actually stopped right here in New York City. And they created this hill by dumping material out the front of the glacier. And then there were big streams and rivers that ran out this way. There's one paper by a geologist from New Jersey that suggests that at a previous time, not the last glaciation, but many glaciations before, there was a version of the Hudson River and it cut through Flushing Meadows here and excavated out in this valley that then became Jamaica Bay. What that means is, of course, under Jamaica Bay is just full of sands and gravel, sands and gravel, sands and gravels. 1,000 feet deep down to the bedrock, which is very different than, say, Manhattan here, where the bedrock is just a few feet deep under the buildings, or in the Bronx on Staten Island. There's a sort of tilting coastal plain or bedrock plain that's underneath Western Long Island, and out here it's 1,000 feet deep down to the bedrock. So we take maps like this, and then we compile them from the shorelines from the various maps we're using, the historical maps, and then we drop the shoreline down to 1609. Figure out where the wetlands might have been. I just wanted to point out this. This is Far Rockaway. This is Far Rockaway, as the Lenape would have known it. There was a Lenape village out here on the end of it. And you can see how it's a little bit higher. And this is the way people used to get to out to the Rockaway Peninsula, is out here. Rockaway, by the way, that's another Lenape name. There was a Chief Rockaway that we get that name from. And he lived right here on this. It's actually a sort of spit of gravel that was left by the glaciers. Something else to point out is like I say, this is very, 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 very level and flat, just very gradually going up. And so what that meant was that you had these huge, extensive wetlands. This is just a little rendering we did. See this little triangle here? It's sort of this view, this way. Almost a mile across these wetlands, right? And then you had these, you know, slightly higher bits that had forest on them coming down toward the edge of the water. Yes. The third thing to say about this model of topography is that you see there's this little stubby thing that looks kind of like the Rockaways, but it's much, much shorter than the Rockaways. And that's the barrier island system on the south shore of Long Island. And this is sort of the western end. And there's what's called a longshore current on the southern edge of Long Island that's bringing sediment up onto this beach all the time. And the motive factor for that is basically the waves. The waves sort of come in and they're carrying sediment. You can see this actually next time you're at the beach. And that forms this long line of beaches here. And it has to do with the way Long Island is tilted relative to the prevailing ocean waves, right? The ocean waves come this direction. So when they come up, and you actually see this if you look out on the beach, it comes up the beach, and then it kind of comes down at an edge. And the way it comes down at an edge and an angle, it pushes the sand this way. And so you can see the way you get these overlapping inlets here, and here, and here. And then when you get all the way to New York City, what's happening is the sand under the, it's going like this, but then here's the Hudson River flow coming out. And so there's all these sand banks that are right off Coney Island and right here. these were of great interest in the 19th century when there was so much coastal navigation trying to come into the bay. That's one of the reasons that Haslam and the Coastal Survey was so important, was trying to find a channel to get through. And there was a guy who worked for Haslam in Gedney, and Gedney found it and became the famous Gedney Channel. And in the 19th century, everybody would have known that. They would have known nothing about the Cross Bronx Expressway. And everybody would have known the Gedney Channel that was right here. There's a similar set of features that's happening along the shores of New Jersey, but just in the other direction, coming out this way. So that's about the shoreline. So this question of where the Rockaways were in 1609 is a difficult question to answer, and something we've tried really hard to try and get a handle on. We've done this by looking at these historical maps, and it occurred to us that because Haskler and his colleagues did such a careful job, they were such good cartographers, that we could actually treat these maps as kind of quantitative data, as if they were surveys, but surveys that we could georeference and do comparisons with. So here's Haskler's map again. His successor was a man named Alexander Dallas Bakke, who was a grandchild of Benjamin Franklin. Again, a very famous scientist in his day. And just watch the Rockaway tip here. Everybody see where it is? It's right here. Just watch this tip. So here's Bakke's map from 1861. Here's the resurvey in 1882. Here's a Tippmann came after Bakke in 1907. And did you see what's happening there with the Rockaways? These are all maps made at the same scale, using essentially the same methods by the same people, the same organization. And you can see it moving out there. So I'll show you this just to show you the shorelines. Here's Haslar, Bakke again, Bien, this is another one, 1891, and then Tippmann in 1907. And you can see how much it moved, right? And if you put the little crosses at the western tips and then look up the GPS coordinates, right, which you can do in the computer, then you can use the distance formula. Everybody remember the distance formula from geometry? And you can calculate how far it moved. And if you average that, it's 77 meters per year in the x direction from east to west, and 32 meters in the north to south direction, which means that between 1844 and 1907, the Rockaways extended 4,851 meters, or approximately 3 miles. 3 miles of new land. It was such an issue that there was actually a big court case about it. In fact, right before the War of 1812, the U.S. government appropriated some land at the very tip of the Rockaway Peninsula because they wanted to build a blockhouse, because they were afraid the British would land at Jamaica Bay and then come up over Brooklyn and attack New York City. And they had good reason to think that, because it kind of happened that way in the American Revolution, right? The whole Battle of Brooklyn. You can go to the Historical Society, they have a nice show on about the Battle of Brooklyn right now. Anyway, so they bought some land there. The British, in the end, decided to burn Washington, D.C., and not New York, so that was okay. But fast forward to the end of the 19th century, now there's 3 miles more land. Who owns that land? Is it the people it was actually a member of the Cornell family that owned the property that was appropriated? Is it the Cornell family that owns that 3 miles of land, or is it the U.S. government? You know, our legal code does not envision that land gets created, right? You know, you get a property and it says, this is your property, and these are the meets and bounds of it. It doesn't imagine that the property goes away or that it comes back again. Turns out they settled, but the U.S. government's had a big part of it, which became Fort Tilden, and we'll enter our story in a little bit. So these blue dots on this map are the ones I just showed you from the 19th century and early 20th century maps. These red dots are when we extrapolate. If the rate of the Rockaways continued growing, it would extend another 5 miles this way. Right? But by the same token, if we were to go back to 1609, it'd be somewhere here in Nassau County, right? So neither of those things happened. It didn't come this way, obviously. And it didn't go that way. It wasn't there in 1609. So that leads us to the question, well, where was it? So for me, that meant, well, maybe I need to look at maps that were earlier. And of course, there are many maps of the New York City region. In fact, what's one of the great pleasures of New York, that people have been so fascinated with this place, they've been drawing maps ever since mapmakers arrived, since the Europeans arrived. In fact, there's an entry in in Pilgrim's Purchase that recounts of one of the early Dutch traders asking a Lenape person to draw on his sea chest the map of New York City in 1610, which we don't have anymore, but it's a fun story. So I started looking at these earlier maps. These maps are much harder to georeference. They're done with a sort of different set of cartographic standards. These ones are really beautiful. This John Eddy was a blind surveyor who worked with people to make these really wonderful maps. He made the first map of 30 miles around New York City, which you've seen, like the hydrological maps now around map. Anyway, he made the first one of those. A colleague of his made this one. They called it after Eddie because this one had sold so well, so they called it this. But this was by John Durstenel. And if you look at, here's the Rockaways, right? Here's the Rockaways. This is 1839. And you see here it says New Inlet Open, January 1839, right here. And there's this feature of Pelican Bar, which down here is actually above water, and here is just a sandbar, which suggests that these sort of evolutions of the Rockaways are continuing to happen, at least back to 1811. Here's 1802, Simeon DeWitt's map of New York State, the first map of the whole state. Here he has Barren Island is sticking out as a jetting like this. Here's the Rockaways. Here's Coney Island. It's a different shape. And notice there's only a couple of islands in the middle of Jamaica Bay. Catherine showed you all that great 20th century photography of the islands of Jamaica Bay, which continue to be of huge interest to the environmental community and to the city. But there were many fewer here. And if you go back to the American Revolution, there's no islands in the middle. There's these extensive marsh wetlands and the streams, and here's the Rockaways, and here's the Barren Island. And, you know, when I first saw this map, I thought, well, they probably just forgot, or maybe they didn't care, or, you know, something, right? Blaskowitz, he was a army surveyor, not a nautical surveyor, so maybe he didn't care about the islands. It was too hard to get there. So I looked at DeBars. DeBars worked for the British Navy. He was a nautical hydrographer. Produced a beautiful volume called The Atlantic Neptune, maps of this part of the world. And this is his map of Jamaica Bay. And you can see he has a slightly different barren island here. Here's the Rockaways. But he only has one island in the middle of Jamaica Bay. And then this indication of shallow water, which is different. And I thought, well, that's odd. If you start going back in time, here's Tidman's map. Sorry, this is on its side. Here's Jamaica Bay. Voogt. 1719, sort of the placental version of Jamaica Bay. the Ryder map. Robert Ryder was a British or an English colonist. He created the first map of Long Island that was actually made from the land side. And he calls it Jamaica Sound. And here's Rookaway. Barren Island doesn't exist here, unless maybe it's this little shallow bar. Here's Coney Island. This is the Jansen map, 1651. This is the first map we have that actually shows some streams, shows these extensive wetlands, shows the Jamaica Plank Road, which had to go around the wetlands. And a little Rockaway point here. This is Peter Minuit, 1631. Peter Minuit, sort of the early governor generals of the Dutch colony of New Amsterdam. And they had it for trading. This is obviously, you know, distorted the way we would know the geography. But there's just a very open bay here. And then Block's map from 1614. This is the first map of New York City we have. If we actually look back to what Henry Hudson said, Robert Jewett was Henry Hudson's first mate. And he wrote in his book, in his logbook, that at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, September 3rd, 1609, we came to three great rivers. We stood along to the northernmost, thinking about going into it. We found it at a very shallow bar, before it, and for we had about 10 foot of water. So these three rivers are, in my interpretation anyway, we can argue about this, but they're Jamaica Bay, they're Raritan south of Staten Island, and they're the Hudson River, which we know is you know, the river that Hudson got named after Hudson. So they went to Jamaica Bay, they couldn't get in. They turned around, went down to Raritan Bay, couldn't get in, and then finally they tried the narrow one through the Narrows, and then course, Hudson thought he hit the gold mine, right? He thought he was on his way to China because that was his main interest. He didn't really care at all about North America. It was just an impediment on the way of getting the cheap stuff out of China. He was very disappointed when he got to Albany. So this is the way we have Jamaica Bay, at least at the present. Things are always subject to change, but you know, a very shallow bar across, a very shallow bay in general. The Rockaway is much shorter. This is based on the Janssen version of it, but we actually don't really know where it is and would require a lot more extensive sediment modeling to actually say. And then these very shallow marshal plains, and you can actually see that if we if I lay on top of that the ecological communities, the different ecosystem types. And this is a bit simplified, but you have these very shallow bay with no marsh islands. You have these extensive fringing wetlands on the side up here, and then surrounding that, of course, was forest and streams. I mean, New York City is a city built in a forest. If you leave any vacant piece of land long enough, trees will grow on it, because that's the climate and the soils of this part of the world, is to be forested. We could do the same trick for 1877, so mid to late 19th century. There's two really great and very, very, very detailed coastal survey charts from 1877 and 1878, one to 5,000 scale, where they did thousands and thousands of depths. So this is how we get the sense of how deep Jamaica Bay was. And we know it very well. There's also indications on these charts of eelgrass, seagrass, a sort of marine grass that grows in the shallow depths, a little bit deeper than the salt marshes. Really important habitat type. And you can see all of these different marsh islands, these really extensive wetlands here. If we compare that, and the thought is that there were two sources of sediment that were filling in Jamaica Bay. One is the marine sediments that are coming around the Rockaway Inlet. That's the way these inlets work. They're constantly filling. That's what's moving it to the west. And then probably also agricultural sediments from the agricultural development around Jamaica Bay. So that's what the brown colors on this map are showing. So you have the Rockaways, they're extending out, they're blocking the wave action. You have agriculture on land. And then you get these marsh islands that form, and they form really rapidly. You know, you see a couple in 1802, you see them in Eddie's map in 1811, and then by Hassler, they're pretty much the wetlands that we see through the rest of the 19th century, and into the 20th century until those 1924 aerial photographs, and then they start to decline again. They've been declining ever since. And the thought is that the Rockaways blocked the wave action and allowed these marshes to form. The marshes require two requirements. They have two habitat requirements. One is not too much wave action, and the second is the right intertidal depths. So they like to be flooded twice per day, but they don't want to be too deep, and they don't want to be too shallow. So this is the Jamaica Bay that was a place for agriculture and also a place of kind of refuge. This is Ramblersville on Hawtree Creek, which the description that goes with this photo talks about how it was sort of a place you could go and hide. Like, it was so far away from New York City. There was no subway back then. You had to take a horse to get back into the city. This was a place a long, long, long way away. Unfortunately, people couldn't leave things good enough, you know, leave things well enough alone. And so there was an idea in the early 20th century to make Jamaica Bay the second port in New York. This is the time, this image is from 1907. This is a time where Brooklyn and Manhattan, the port was just full up. It just couldn't take anymore. Eventually, the second port became New Jersey, right? It came over here, Bergen Neck and Newark and so forth. But there were people, there were boosters that wanted to be in New York. They wanted to be in Jamaica Bay. And this was their concept. This is actually an image that was made for an invitation to a fancy dinner to celebrate this idea. And you can see this like industrialized port on the islands here. You can see these bulkheaded wharves all the way around. These channels are indicating places that were dredged to make it easy for ship travel to get around. And you see this, there's even a canal that would have gone through the moraine connected to Flushing Meadows. I mean, it's quite astounding in its way, you know, for its, breadth of vision, if you like. it's not what I would have wanted to see, but, you know, I mean, you have to give them to them. That's ambitious, right? It didn't happen this way. It didn't happen this way, but it started to happen this way. So they started to do some things. They started to dredge. They started to fill. They started to bulkhead. But they didn't finish the job. So it didn't become this, but it also kind of messed up what it was before. And in some ways, it led to the Jamaica Bay that we have today. I would trace many of our problems in Jamaica Bay with flooding and with environment to these decisions that were made 100 years ago, the vision people had 100 years ago for what Jamaica Bay could be. You can see this sort of deep dredge channel that goes all the way around. This wider bit here, these are the borrow pits. So when JFK Airport was built, they borrowed the sediment from the bottom of Jamaica Bay and dumped it on the marshes. It was Idlewild Airport that was built on top of Idlewild Golf Course, which was built on top of the wetlands that were there previously. Similarly over here, Floyd Bennett Field is all on fill. Floyd Bennett Field was the first airfield. It's interesting because, you know, by the time aeronautical travel was, you know, becoming a commercial entity in the 1920s and 1930s, the city had really built out, right? This was the time of the streetcars and the early cars. You could actually start to live out here in Brooklyn and get into Manhattan to go to work. And so there was actually less space for these new airports. And if you think about it, a lot of the airports are built on tidal wetlands. You know, JFK here, LaGuardia, Floyd Bennett Field, which is now abandoned and part of the Park Service, but it was an airfield. San Francisco Airport or Oakland Airport in the Bay Area. You know, many, many airports. And that's because the land near close by was already all developed. So that's why they built out here, which is why these, you know, really important pieces of infrastructure are susceptible to flooding. So you have several things happening. You have stabilization of the Rockaway Peninsula. This starts with the military at Fort Tilden. They start building groins to hold the beach in place. You have dredging of the channels and the tributaries. You have a landfill used to create airports and housing and other kinds of development. And you have bulkheading. And the net effect of all of these things is to sort of stabilize those dynamics that I was talking about at the beginning. They're kind of trying to hold Jamaica Bay in place. Because if you can hold it in place, then it becomes land for development, right? And people will go and live there. And Robert Moses, you know, helps out by building the Belt Parkway, right? Which is meant to, like, take people out to Long Island and go to the parks, but in fact becomes a commuter highway, as we all know it today. He also builds the subway system to bring people out to the Rockaways. There hadn't been anybody, you know, the Lenape did not live on the Rockaways. They lived on Far Rockaway, which was high and out of the, not on the beach, but up above. And nobody in the 19th century lived out there, except for a few big hotels that burnt down. And it really wasn't until the late 19th, early 20th century that people actually started to develop out here, and really it didn't take off until after World War II. Which leads us to this map, which is the land uses of today, where the red areas are the urban areas, right? You can see the salt marshes, you can see some of the fill areas that Catherine showed you, right? So really different land use, completely different kinds of ecosystems today. The Rockaways have been stabilized and developed and flooded. We've had extensive urbanization. The marsh islands are disappearing. Oops. I didn't mention that, you know, there's water treatment plants. There were three landfills. You know, for a long time, the city treated Jamaica Bay as the place to put stuff it didn't otherwise want. When we think about resilience in Jamaica Bay, it has all these long-term legacies of decisions that were made over hundreds of years that have led us to the point we are in today. So I'll just conclude with a few comments that come out of a study that I just finished with Philip Horton and Kit McManus and Alan Bloomberg. Philip and Alan are really talented oceanographers. New York City is so lucky to have them. Even though they work in New Jersey at the Stevens Institute of Technology, we'll count them as part of our New Yorkers. They have kids up at the Earth Institute of Columbia at season. And our idea was, well, you know, maybe we could take these different landscapes, which, you know, if you compare them, they're so different. These are the different DEMs for 1609, 1877, and today. And these are our land cover maps. And these are the main inputs that you need to an oceanographic model. And that's what the Stevens people have, is they have this really detailed hydrodynamic model, a model of where water moves in New York City that you can run storms with. And so we worked for 2.5 years with some funding from NOAA, from the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, and created this new website called adaptmap.info. Which I invite you to go and look at. It's the results of our work. But I'll show you some of the highlights here. Everything I'm going to show you is things that you can just download. So these are storm simulations in 1609. So uh, the oceanographers talk about these return frequencies for storms. So this is a once in 10 year storm. So that's a big storm. It's not a gigantic storm, but it's a big storm once every 10 years. And you can see that what happens, this little chart down here is showing you the water levels. There's a little line that moves along here. It's coordinated with this, and the colors are showing you the depths. So the blues are shallow depths, and the red are bigger depths. And you can see that with the very open Jamaica Bay, the water comes in, fills up those wetlands, gets to the top, and then flows back out. In and out, just like a heart beating. If you run the 10-year storm over the landscape today, you know, the water has to go around here, right? It has to go in this inlet. You know, this is all stabilized. It has to go in here, and then it has to kind of get out. And in the process of getting out, it floods, right? So, see that? So that red over the white, that's people's houses being flooded. That's what we're trying to avoid. That's a problem. And the only way to really avoid the problem is either for the houses to move or for the water not to get there, right? And those are the two solutions to offer. So you can do this game, but now with a 100-year storm. And for 1609, it's a little bit more expensive. You can see it going up the old stream beds. But it's basically the same game, right? So those salt marshes, they flood, but they also provide space for the water to go and to go back out. And they're adapted to being flooded. So it's not bad for them. It's actually good for them. It removes the rack and takes it away. Less so today. And that's a 100-year storm. Sandy, you know, Philip tells me it's between a 300 and a 400-year storm. It was a really big storm. You know, certainly a once-in-a-lifetime kind of event, but so severe. And, you know, the Rockaways up here behind the airport, well, all the old salt marshes basically trying to go back to water again. So, you know, that's fine to study it, but what's really interesting to think about, well, how did you fix it? And our notion was, maybe you fix it by trying to restore nature, right? Trying to work with the system instead of trying to engineer it into something else. And so for us, that means, you know, maybe if you shallow. If you shallow the bay, then it means there's less places for the water to go. The water doesn't go in the first place. It stays out here in the ocean. But there's a lot more space for the water to be, so there's less flooding. And then if you do some things to try and narrow the inlet here, an important proviso here is, of course, you'd only want it to fill. It turns out these dredge channels are deeper than they need to be for navigation. So even if you fill them just to the navigation depth, but you want to make sure you use clean fill. You know, there's a big worry for me and a worry for a lot of the residents that somebody might use some nasty dredge fill from someplace else that they need to get rid of in Jamaica Bay. There's laws against this. There was there's been a law in the books for the last several years that was just renewed for another 5 years, saying you can't use toxic fill in Jamaica Bay. But you still have to find this sort of clean sand to put it in. And the amazing thing, and you can see this on a depth map, this is that 1 in 10 year storm. It's the maximum flood. So that's all these areas here, the maximum flood. And if you were to narrow the inlet and shallow the bay, then you would get this. That's 40,000 less people getting flooded by just helping Jamaica Bay be more natural than it is today. And the benefits work out too. This, you know, we had a $300,000 project. The Army Corps just finished a $20 billion project. So we haven't had as much emphasis on the cost, but the cost-to-benefit ratio works out 3 to 4 to 1, mostly because the damages potentially in Jamaica Bay are so huge from flooding. And then this is a slide that Philip asked me to show, and it actually is a really important point, which is there's a lot of people that compare New York to the Dutch, right? You know, I mean, the Dutch came here in the first place, right? So maybe they've been dealing with flooding for a really long time. But the North Sea is not the same thing as the Atlantic Ocean. This is the return period on this graph, and this is the flood height, right? So these are bigger and bigger and bigger storms that are less and less and less frequent. And you can see how much steeper this curve is for New York, which suggests that, you know, it just takes a little, for the blue line is for the Netherlands. So you build something that's like this size, you know, and it helps you for all these things. But, you know, just a small increment just gets you a little bit more. For New York, it's a much steeper curve. which suggests there probably is no such thing as total coastal protection for New York City. There's no way to just keep everything we've had because we had it before into the future, especially given sea level rise. So, less focus on vertical barriers and more focus on things we can do in an incremental way that will bend and not break. The thing about a floodgate is it's fine until it gets over top, and then you're really messed up. Right? As New Orleans found out, right? That was really the problem with New Orleans, is they had flood protection, but it just wasn't big enough. And so when it overtopped, it actually made the problem worse, not better. Nature doesn't work like that. Nature actually adjusts and does it the best it can at each she level, and it's something we can build incrementally as we need to go. I'll just show another conception that's sort of in this line of thinking. This is Kate Orff's Rebuild by Design project for the South Shore of Staten Island, these living breakwater projects where you basically try and construct something that's similar to a barrier island system. It can also provide habitat that then protects the beaches out here. There's such creativity, and Catherine's work is in this mode. Many, many people have suggested really creative and interesting ways to try and work with nature to reduce flooding instead of trying to fight against it. But the current mode is basically in this mode, beach stabilization. And you understand why this is, because people have properties they don't want to wash away. And if everything you own is in your home, then the most important thing for you is not to have it washed away. And so this is why there's so much political pressure for beach stabilization and for floodgates to try and keep the water out and not adapt ourselves, to try and adapt nature to us instead of us adapting a little bit to nature. So, my concern about this over the long term, and I'm just wrapping up now, is, we build these protective measures, and then that actually creates the conditions where urban development happens. And urban development, when it gets messed up, when it gets flooded or damaged, then creates the demand for more protection measures, which then create more opportunity for urban development, which creates more opportunity for protection measures. And this goes around and around, and the numbers keep getting bigger and bigger every time. So the question is, how long will it last, right? And what happens to the country when Jamaica Bay floods and there's a big fire out west and there's a tornado in the Midwest? We can't keep treating these recurring events in nature as if each one is a natural disaster visited on us by God, right? Some sort of odd punishment that then the rest of society needs to make us up for. We need to be smart enough to actually adapt our cities and our country and our world to living with the conditions that are here. And I really think that's the big lesson out of Manahata, right? It's not that, we took this beautiful thing and we destroyed it. We took this beautiful thing and we created another beautiful thing. But if we love it as much as we do, as at least I do, then we should want to see it last for a long time. And that means it's going to have to continue to change, not just keep it the way it is, but continue to adapt it using our creativity and our arts and our culture and all the energy that's in this room and that's in the programs that New York City H2O does and the kind of work that Catherine does at City College and what we're trying to do at WCS. I mean, this is really the moment where we need to bring all of our energy and all of our capacity to the question of how do we live here for a long time into the future. So thank you very much.
So that was great. Thank you so much, Eric. It's a really wonderful presentation. I'm going to just make a few comments,
sure.
I think, on the presentation. Maybe start with a lead-in question or two, and then we'd love to open it up to the audience, because I'm sure you have plenty of questions for Eric as well. Looking at the maps, maybe you remember an anecdote. I'm very interested in etymology. So there's a very interesting tracing of that expression, rose-colored glasses. I'm not sure if you're aware of that. But apparently that phrase comes from the phenomenon where map makers of the old days were so precise and so careful about what they drew and how they remind me of your Hassler character, who presents us with the most precise and extraordinary maps of the city, not only the shoreline, but also the depths of the water. But apparently they were always looking through their glasses, and rose petals were the best thing to clean the lenses of those glasses. So they would take their glasses off and polish the lenses with the rose petals, leaving a rosy residue through which they saw the world. So it occurs to me that you're something of this rose-colored glasses cartographer of today. And I say that mostly because I know your good spirit as well as your optimism with which you look at the world. So I guess that's my first question. There was an interesting pamphlet produced in the 30s by Robert Moses called The Future of Jamaica Bay. And I guess my prompt to you is, what through your lenses do you see as the future of Jamaica Bay in 2016?
Well, thank you for that. I didn't know about that, about the rose-colored glasses. I love that. We should put that on my gravestone. that's a wonderful thing. So, you know, I think, so New York City has some hard choices about Jamaica Bay going forward, right? And I think it's, we talk about adaptation to climate, and I think, you know, if you think about the sandpiper and the diamondback terrapin, the turtle I showed at the beginning, you know, those are two different strategies for dealing with getting flooded. The sandpiper strategy is you use it for as long as you can, and when the big flood's coming, you fly away. You know, that's what they do. They don't hang out on the beach during Hurricane Sandy. They leave. And then they come back as soon as it's done. And the diamondback terrapin, they're actually this, you know, really great species that's adapted to living in salt water. It's one of the few, you know, other than sea turtles, one of the few terrestrial turtles that's adapted to this. They're so adapted, actually, that, you know, they have troubles with the salt balance, the homeostasis, and so they cry tears of salt. It's really beautiful. And so they stay, but they're specially adapted to. And so I think that's what we should do in our flood zone. You know, we either build things that are designed to be flooded every once in a while, or we design things that are designed to move away. And I think mostly that's not single family homes, right? Or, you know, I don't think that's housing. I think it's other sorts of things. And so I guess that's my vision for the long term. And the challenge for us isn't like knowing that's what's needed. I think it's kind of obvious. Think about it, but that's what's needed. The question is, how do we do that through our social system? I mean, we can do it the way nature will do it, which is just sometime nature will whack all those people that are there, right, again. And that's going to suck. And we know who loses in that situation is the poor, right? And we don't want that. So, you know, that's really the challenge of our time. My dad used to say, you know, we're all so smart, we're all very intelligent, but are we any wiser than before 10,000 years ago? You know, I don't know. I mean, that's really what we need in the 21st century is the wisdom to use the information that we have to make the right decisions for our city and for our country and so forth. So, good question.
I think we can open that up to questions, and there's a roving microphone.
My name is Daniel Clark, I'm a professional engineer, and I have a 1903-1904 map of New York City and Long Island. Really great map produced for the Brooklyn water system to show the potential for Long Island as a source of water for New York City.
Yeah.
And it shows very, very accurately where the salt marshes were in 1903, 1904.
Yeah.
And if you'd like to borrow this map, which I've framed, you can do so, and I will speak to you after the lecture's over.
Thank you. Thank you for that kind offer.
First question here.
Yeah. Questions, and I'll also ask Catherine. She knows a lot.
Eric, thank you for that. Jennifer Bolstead and I teach at Parsons New School, and a lot of the students this semester have been building off the work that you've been doing and the work that Catherine's been doing. It's a Master of Architecture studio, so it's not a landscape. But one of the things that came sifting out of the research, and I wonder if this was on your radar, is when you showed the slide of New York Bight, where you showed 5 and 10,000 year line.
Yeah.
Which I probably too hard to pull it up, but there's the cutting edge of archaeology is scuba archaeology, you know, trying to go out to that point and estimate, you know, where North American settlement happened,
yeah,
between that 5 and 10,000 line roughly.
Yeah.
And there's a few bits of evidence of archaeology just off, you know, Sandy Hook and off Rockaway. In those lines, and I wonder if you pull anything more out of it. It was just like something that came out of it. I would like to connect the dots with your work in some way or another in the future.
Yeah, don't know if I have anything particular to say about that, except that you know, it's so imaginative the work that an archaeologist has to do, right? So if you were, if you're trying to find sites from 5,000 or 10,000 years ago, you have to imagine that landscape, which isn't there anymore, so it's underwater, right? I mean, the oldest site in New York City is 8,000 years old, and it's from Staten Island. And, you know, Staten Island was just a little, was a hill, right? You know? And there was a little valley where the Arthur Kill was, but somehow that was a good place for people to live. So you have to really give it to not just the archaeologists, but the geologists too, right? Like the acts of imagination that geologists have to make are just so, so incredible, right? To imagine, you know, such a long period of time, but also these dramatic changes that have happened in the landscape. I mean, just, you know, catastrophes, mountains raised, mountains destroyed, you know, storms, thousands and thousands and thousands of storms. It's just an incredible piece of imagination. Yeah.
On that geology comment you made,
I
listened to this debate between two geologists about the Hudson River shifting course.
Yeah.
And the debate wasn't resolved. There's just not enough evidence
about
whether or not the Hudson River punctured the glaciation. But one of them said if it happened, it might have happened in a matter of weeks or days, right?
Yeah.
Over time.
Yeah.
Right. That was some significant event that happened. That was interesting, a punctuated pulse, right?
Yeah. There's a paper that talks about, you know, as the glaciers retreating, the ice is melting away, but there would be these plugs of ice. One hypothesis, there was one at the Arizona Narrows, and it created this lake, glacial Lake Albany, that went all the way up the Hudson River Valley. And at some moment, there was another glacial lake that was in upstate New York, and maybe something broke there, and the water flowed into glacial Lake Albany, and then flowed down, and it broke the ice at the Arizona Narrows. Can you imagine this?
Yeah.
This huge wave of fresh water washed out, and there's even some people that think that there was enough fresh water that it changed the Gulf Stream for a couple of years, which then changed the climate. Right? I mean, it's really a remarkable event. There's an event that's well known out west, the Missoula floods created sort of western Washington, but we might have had that very own version. It's just ours, it's all, as we say, underwater.
Yeah. First of all, thank you. I remember first job city planning a discussion of the beaches. And there were some people who think it was just a question of dumping a lot of sand. And I learned that the beaches move and they go west, et cetera. And very instructive. There was a reference earlier to links to some documents. There's nothing on the handout. Will those be on the website or someplace else accessible? Else I missed it.
I'm sure we can arrange that.
Right?
Yes.
And last and perhaps most important, where do we go from here, and who should do what? Is there a document, preferably pithy, a couple of pages, that lists the options and the pluses and minuses that folks can use in talking to legislators in particular?
Yeah. Well, in my world, that's a very active area today.
Well, you've got a good crowd here tonight.
Yeah.
Well, what do you want folks here who to do different, better when they leave than when they came in?
I mean, I think what we need to do is we need to learn to live with nature, as we're talking about. If you're interested in Jamaica Bay in particular, that adaptmap.info that I mentioned in my talk is a really good place. You can see all the scenarios. We ran a large number of scenarios with different storm concerns. And I really can, you know, if we could solve some of the issues around how the filling might happen, I really think that would really help Jamaica Bay. But I have to say it's a little bit of a minority opinion in the wider world of these things. So.
Hi, my name is Alex. Thanks for coming to talk to us. My question is, you know, I know you talked about flexibility as being an initiative, but I imagine some of that involves wetland expansion. Maybe you could talk a little bit about how water toxicity might impact the ability to have like healthy wetlands, even if people wanted to expand them.
Yeah. So a big mystery about the Jamaica Bay wetlands, I don't know, Kevin, you want to speak to this too, is you know, there is effluent that's coming out of the water treatment plants in Jamaica Bay. There's four of them, three managed by New York City, one by Nassau County. Particularly New York City DEP has gone to heroic efforts to try and reduce the nitrogen loading. It's gone down by half from where it was in the 1990s, which is kind of amazing, and it's billions of dollars of investment to make that happen. But it's still something like 26,000 pounds of nitrogen per day. 99% of the fresh water that goes into Jamaica Bay is coming through the sewer system, right? It's actually water that comes from the Catskills and, you know, the chrome aqueduct system, and then through our pipes, and then through our showers and toilets and sinks, and then to the water treatment plant, and then it goes out. And it carries a high nitrogen load that's, you know, 90% higher or 100% higher than what it would have been naturally. But nobody knows exactly what that means. It's an area of active research, and it's something that the DEP and the DEC are working really hard to try and decrease. But I think that's one of the issues when you have to think about these flood measures, right? You know, the Army Corps is basically tasked with thinking about flood protection, but the DEP has to think about water quality, right? And the Parks Department has to think about the wetlands. And so we need a solution that actually works across all these different domains, that would improve water quality, that would improve the ecosystem functioning, and that would help provide some flood protection. And that's where I think, you know, the natural systems are probably the best way going forward. I think for the wetlands, though, even more perhaps than the chemistry, there's an issue of sediment starvation. You know, the same stabilized Rockaway that, you know, makes it hard for the water to get in, and once it gets in, makes it flood, and then have a hard time getting back out. Also, is keeping the sediments that come from the land, you know, the marine environment into the bay. That also probably is impacting the long-term stability of the wetlands. And then the last thing is sea level rise. You know, sea level rise is continuing to happen, and the curves are predicting, you know, greater sea level rise. But we don't know how much. It's greater uncertainty coming up, and so it's this, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 different levels of threat coming at the wetlands all at the same time. So it's hard. It may be that 50 or 100 years from now, we won't have the interior wetlands again in Jamaica Bay, but the islands won't be stable. But there's a lot of people that don't want that to happen. So.
We'll take 2 more questions.
Thank you. What do you think of the wisdom of placing the high pressure gas pipeline right through Jamaica Bay, where the floods, the floor of Jamaica Bay is naturally dynamic, but especially when we have a record-breaking storm? What's your take on the choice to
move the pipeline? I wonder if you have an opinion about that question.
I just might, but I want to hear your
Well, I don't think we should put, you know, significant infrastructure like this carrying explosive gases in the way of serious storms.
Sorry, I don't actually have a question, but I really wanted to mention the fact that there is a pipeline called the Spectra Energy Pipeline that is there working very hard to complete this as rapidly as possible. Like the pipeline at Standing Rock, there's no environmental impact statement, and like the proposition that the pipeline at Standing Rock, they have used all kinds of contrary and tricky proposals to actually trick the public.